Are mortals bearing rings of power immortal? Those carrying the rings are said to not gain new life, but they continue to exist, and the likes of Frodo and Bilbo Baggins do not age in any noticeable way. This video will take a look at what immortality is in Tolkien's world, and will aim to show that the great rings of power do not bless or curse mortals with immortality as we know it, but allow them to exist and suffer under a power that was never intended for them to experience. The relationship between mortality and immortality, between elves and men, is related to the destiny of each kindred. Both races have a relationship to Arda itself and the music of the Einar, that great music that took place before time, from which Eru Iluvatar then brought the material universe into being. With elves, they are doomed with loving the beauty of the world and using their gifts of delicacy and perfection to bring the world to full flower. They will last while the world lasts and will never leave it, even if they are unnaturally separated from their bodies through grief or violence. Elves who are slain or leave their bodies are inclined to reach the halls of Mandos. As the firstborn, they are to welcome the arrival of the secondborn, the race of men, teaching them and making way for them. This will lead to elves fading as the followers absorb the life from which both proceed. This is the destiny of the race of elves, immortal beings who are bound to the world, sharing in its bliss, its grief, and the unfolding of its history. Whereas the elves remain until the end of days, and their love of the earth and all the world is more single and more poignant therefore, and as the years lengthen, ever more sorrowful, for the elves die not till the world dies, unless they are slain or waste in grief. Neither does age subdue their strength, unless one grows weary of 10,000 centuries, and dying they are gathered to the halls of Mandos and Valinor, whence they may in time return. Mortality is existing without your spirit being bound to the world. Men are free to shape their destiny beyond the music that was in the beginning. While the destiny of elves is linked with the great music, men stand apart from it. This is one reason why the Valar share an affinity with the elves and lack in their understanding of men. Tolkien tells us that the dealings of the Einar have been mostly with the elves, for Eru made the elves more like in nature to the Einar, though the elves were less in might and stature. With men being allowed to grow and shape their fate, they exist somewhat separately from the elves and the Einar. After a brief moment of time, men are believed to leave the world, with legends saying that they return at the world's end to take part in the greater music that is to come, a second music of the Einar that will not only involve the Einar, but all of the children of Iluvatar. All will understand their part, all will be in harmony, and themes shall take being as they are uttered. Immortal were the elves, but men were more frail, more easily slain by weapon or mischance, and less easily healed, subject to sickness and many ills, and they grew old and died. What may befall their spirits after death, the elves know not. Some say that they too go to the halls of Mandos, but their place of waiting there is not that of the elves, and Mandos under Iluvatar alone, save Manwë, knows whither they go after the time of recollection in those silent halls beside the outer sea. When it comes to immortality and mortality, it is beyond the power of the Einar to grant immortality to a mortal, which is essentially removing the gift of men, a gift bestowed upon the race of men by Eru. Mortality and immortality stem from Eru, the One, with men seeking a place beyond the world, finding no rest within it. They have the virtue to shape their lives, all amid the powers and chances of the world. Those aware of the history of Ardor will know of figures who were once mortal or immortal, and were altered in some way. This is explained by Tolkien, with the doom of each race being decreed by Eru, unable to be overruled by any beneath him, without a direct act of God. For elves and men were the creation of Eru himself, with the Valar having no part in their making. Immortality and mortality being the special gifts of God to the Eruhini, in whose conception and creation the Valar had no part at all. It must be assumed that no alteration of their fundamental kind could be affected by the Valar, even in one case. The cases of Luthien and Tuor, and the position of their descendants, was a direct act of God. This means that the One Ring and the other great rings of power, despite the great power within them, are unable to grant true immortality to mortals. It is beyond the capability of anyone dwelling in the physical world, including Sauron, to alter the fate of men in this way, without the direct blessing of Eru. With cases in the Legendarium of beings accepting the gift of men or rejecting it, such as Luthien or Arwen, Eru was always the one granting the change, even through servants such as Namo or Manwë. Sauron has no permission or blessing from Eru, or the power within him, to circumvent the fate of the children of Iluvatar through his devices.
A mortal, Frodo, who keeps one of the great rings, does not die. But he does not grow or obtain more life. He merely continues, until at last every minute is weariness. And if he often uses the ring to make himself invisible, he fades. He becomes, in the end, invisible permanently, and walks in the twilight under the eye of the dark power that rules the rings. Yes, sooner or later. Later, if he is strong or well-meaning to begin with, but neither strength nor good purpose will last. Sooner or later, the dark power will devour him.
We see this happen with Bilbo Baggins, who starts to feel a great weariness, and with someone like Gollum, who exists in a constant state of longing for the very thing that tortures him. It is as if the spirit itself feels it is being forced to remain, unnaturally, beyond the brief time it is supposed to exist on Earth. Tolkien tells us that each of the races has a natural span that is integral to its biological and spiritual nature. This cannot be increased in quality or quantity. Tolkien speaks of this, like the prolongation of time, as a wire being stretched out ever tauter, like the spreading of butter ever thinner. The butter and the wire do not increase in any way, but are merely stretched out over a greater space. For a mortal, the spirit then suffers an intolerable torment the longer this process continues. Save for the One Ring, the rings of power were made by elves, for elves, for the halting of decay and for preservation. The elvish motive to see change as a regrettable thing, allowing what is desired or loved to remain as it is. The rings of power work as intended, and were for those already bound to the world. For them to carry and use these rings, there would be no intolerable torment, as the spirit was naturally set to endure the passing of great ages and time. It is completely unnatural for mortals to hold this power, and their suffering is the result of mortals becoming entwined with the world of immortals. We can call this immortality of the pseudo-kind, the stretching of life until every moment spent on Earth is a desperate feeling of wanting to finally escape.